And welcome to the first Sunday after Thanksgiving. This is a day of Thanksgiving. This is a Eucharist. And I invite you to rise and join in all the responses of this modern rite.
Thank you.
everlasting God, increase in us your gift of faith, forsaking what lies behind and reaching out to what is before, we may run the way of your commandments and win the crown of everlasting joy. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Please be seated for the word. The first lesson is written in the book of Job, chapter 38, beginning at the first verse. Then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind. Who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Gird up your loins like a man. I will question you, and you shall declare to me. Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me, if you have understanding, who determined its measurements? Surely you know. Or who stretched the line upon it? On what were its bases sunk? Or who laid its cornerstone when the morning stars sang together and all the heavenly beings shouted for joy? Or who shut in the sea with doors when it burst out from the womb? When I made the clouds its garment and thick darkness its swaddling band, and prescribed bounds for it and set bars and doors and said, thus far shall you come and no farther, and here shall your proud wings be stopped. Have you commanded the morning since your days began, and caused the dawn to know its place, so that it might take hold of the skirts of the earth, and the wicked be shaken out of it? It is changed like clay under the steel, and it is dyed like a garment. Light is withheld from the wicked, and their uplifted arm is broken. Have you entered into the springs of the sea, or walked in the recesses of the deep? Have the gates of death been revealed to you, or have you seen the gates of deep darkness? Have you comprehended the expanse of the earth? Declare, if you know all this. Where is the way to the dwelling of light, and where is the place of darkness, that you may take it to its territory, and that you may discern the paths to its home? Surely you know, for you were born then, and the number of your days is great. Have you entered the storehouses of the snow, or have you seen the storehouses of the hail, which I have reserved for the time of trouble, for the day of battle and war? What is the way to the place where the light is distributed, or where the east wind is scattered upon the earth? Who has cut a channel for the torrents of rain, and a way for the thunderbolt, to bring rain on a land where no one lives, on the desert, which is empty of human life, to satisfy the waste and desolate land, and to make the ground put forth grass? Has the rain a father? Or who has begotten the drops of dew? From whose womb did the ice come forth? And who has given birth to the hoarfrost of heaven? The waters become hard like stone, and the face of the deep is frozen. Can you bind the chains of the Pleiades, or loose the cords of Orion? Can you lead forth the Maseroth in their season? Or can you guide the bear with its children? Do you know the ordinances of the heavens? Can you establish their rule on the earth?
And you lift up your voice to the clouds, so that a flood of waters may cover you. Can you send forth lightnings, so that they may go and say to you, here we are? Who has put wisdom in the inward parts, or given understanding to the mind? Who has the wisdom to number the clouds? Or who can jump the water skins of the heavens, where the dust runs into a mass and the clods cling together? Can you hunt the prey for the lion, or satisfy the appetite of the young lions when they crouch in their dens or lie in wait in their covert? Who provides for the raven its prey when its young ones cry to God and wander about for lack of food? The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The 104th Psalm. Bless the Lord, O my soul.
You are clothed with majesty and splendor.
You wrap yourself with light as with a cloak,
and spread out the heavens like a curtain.
You lay the beams of your chambers in the waters above.
You ride on the wings of the wind.
You make the winds your messengers.
You make flames of fire your servants.
You have set the earth upon its foundations.
So it never shall move any time.
You covered it with the deep as with a mantle.
The waters stood higher than the mountains.
At your rebuke they hastened away.
At the voice of your thunder
you set the limits that they should not pass.
They shall not be any here.
You sent the springs into the valleys.
They flow between the mountains.
All the beasts of the field drink their fill from them.
And the wild beasts quench their thirst.
O Lord, how manifold are your works.
In wisdom you have made them all.
The earth and sea are full of your creatures.
Creatures both small and great.
There move the ships, and there is that Leviathan.
Which you have made for the sport of it.
All of them look to you.
You give them their food in due season.
When you take away their breath,
they die and return to the dust.
You send forth your spirit, and they are created.
And so you renew the face of the earth.
May the glory of the Lord endure forever.
May the Lord rejoice in all his works.
I will sing to the Lord as long as I live.
I will praise my God while I have my name.
Bless the Lord, O my soul.
Hallelujah.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end.
The second reading is written in the book of Hebrews, chapter 5, beginning at the first verse. Every high priest is chosen from among mortals, is put in charge of things pertaining to God on their behalf, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. He is able to deal gently with the ignorant and wayward, since he himself is subject to weakness. And because of this, he must offer sacrifice for his own sins, as well as for those of the people. And one does not presume to take this honor, but takes it only when called by God, just as Aaron was. So also, Christ did not glorify himself in becoming a high priest, but was appointed by the one who said to him, "You are my son. Today I have begotten you." As he says also in another place, "You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek." In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered, and having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him, having been designated by God a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. About this, we have much to say that is hard to explain, since you have become dull in understanding. For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the basic elements of the oracles of God. You need milk, not solid food. For everyone who lives on milk, being still an infant, is unskilled in the word of righteousness. But solid food is for the mature, for those whose faculties have been trained by practice to distinguish good from evil. Therefore, let us go on towards perfection, leaving behind the basic teaching about Christ and not laying again the foundation, repentance from dead works and faith towards God, instruction about baptism, laying on of hands, resurrection of the dead, and eternal judgment. And we will do this if God permits. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Would you please rise for the gospel song?
Show us the same. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came forward to Jesus and said to him, Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you. And Jesus said to them, What is it you want me to do for you? And they said to him, Grant us to sit one at your right hand and one at your left in your glory. But Jesus said to them, You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink, or be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with? And they replied, We are able. Then Jesus said to them, The cup that I drink, you will drink, and with the baptism with which I am baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared. When the 10 disciples heard this, they began to be angry with James and John. So Jesus called them and said to them, You know that among the Gentiles, those whom they recognize as their rulers lord it over them, and their great ones are tyrants over them. But it shall not be so among you. But whoever wishes to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wishes to be first among you must be slave of all. For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. This is a homily about arguing with God. And I have to tell you that in my preaching it to myself, it changed course several times. So please be patient with me this particular morning. If I say that it's good to argue with God, I believe I'm speaking from the center of our tradition. There are other approaches, of course. There is the approach which imagines God to be all-powerful but uninterested in our puny affairs. God who is majestic, powerful, but who is not interested in how things turn out for his creatures. This is perhaps why some people turn to the opposite view, or were tempted to the opposite view, which is God is a pretty nice guy, but he's not very powerful. God sympathizes with us in our sorrows, but God can't really change things. There are greater forces at work. Our tradition, and the heart of our tradition, is the scripture, encourages us to be in dialogue with God, to bargain, to debate, to argue, but never to stop talking. I'm heartened, for example, by those in our tradition who show us the way. Abraham and Sarah, the grandparents of our faith and of the Jews. When they were told that the hope of the world lay in them and that their offspring, them having traveled up from the Mesopotamian Valley as nomads, that their offspring would bless the world. And it didn't come, and it didn't happen. Sarah laughed, and Abraham said, Really, how could it be? But God did not despise them for that. It's just that the answer they got was not the answer they expected. And Abraham, in the 18th chapter of the book of Genesis, hearing that Sodom was doomed, that the injustice of man to man, of human to human, was so great that the city would collapse in on itself, said to God, but what if there were 50 people? I've got family there. And God said, maybe. And then Abraham said, well, what about 45? Do you remember the story? And then 40, and 30, and 20, and 10? And in the end, the city did collapse. But Abraham is not despised for bargaining with God. And then there is the apostle after whom our parish is named, St. Paul, who three times falls into a passionate argument with God that the thorn in his flesh might be removed. And each time, the answer is no, but God does not despise him for approaching him. And then there is Jesus Christ, the eternal word of the Father himself, praying in Gethsemane in Matthew and Mark and Luke, praying that the burden, the weight of the sins of the world may not fall on him and consume him. And the Lord hears him. And yet, he does bear the burden of the sins of the world. If it is always good to communicate with God, to debate, to bargain, to argue, how is it that we should do it? And the scriptures that we have this morning point the way forward for us. If we look at the book of Job, we remember that we started this book a few weeks ago, and that Job was not privy to the details of the mystery of how this suffering after catastrophe, after disaster, fell upon him. He simply doesn't know. His friends, after a brief period of sympathy, go for a God who stays with the rules. They say to him, Job, there are rules for the way the universe runs, morally. You've overlooked something. You've missed something. Because something such as what happened to you could have never happened in the laws of the universe, and God is a God of the laws of the universe. And Job says, yes, God is a God of the laws of the universe. He's missed something. If only I could speak to that God. If only I could point out what went amiss. And in the end, the friends never speak to God, but Job does speak to God. He cries out to God. He lays his complaint before God. And though his approach in the end is not what is needed, he is not despised for arguing with God. And then God responds. And you've heard the response. It's peppered with rhetorical questions of who, where, how. Really? Some sarcastic, some driving and personal. And in the end, it's not a problem that Job or anyone argues with God. The real point lies in waiting for an answer. And the answer that comes to Job is that God is just not another character in his life. God is not another creature. God is not another actor in the play. If anything, God is the playwright. So, if you want to argue with God, and you should, remember that God is outside the story. God is the creator of all, the sustainer of all, the mover of all. The great South American theologian Gustavo Gutierrez, better known as the Liberation Theology, says in his book, Job, God Talk and the Suffering of the Innocent, that it's not that God doesn't have a plan, Job discovers, but that God's plan is so far beyond his human capacity to understand. And yet Job is not criticized for arguing with God. The disciples, you've heard, Now, for what the fourth or fifth time are struggling with the whole idea of power. And James and John, who come up often in the Gospel of Mark, step forward and they see Jesus perhaps lingering behind the other disciples, at least that's what it looks like we're to imagine. And they catch Jesus and say, "Can you do for us what we ask? How much like our prayers is that?" But God does not despise their request. He walks them through it. Are you able to drink the cup? Oh yes, we're able to drink the cup. Will they learn to drink the cup? We find out. And he says, you know, but to assign who goes where in the kingdom come is not mine. But they're not despised for asking the question, for wanting to persuade Jesus, for arguing with Jesus. And finally, we come to today's epistle, in which the author takes on the question of Gethsemane, and he plays it out. And he tells us the incredible, that the eternal Word of God, the second person of the Trinity, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, not only suffered, but was made perfect through suffering. What does that mean? It means, I think, that though Jesus cried out that the weight of the sins of the world, if it were God's will, be held from him, it was not. But that God did not despise his cry. St. John Chrysostom, 1600 years ago, said, here's the thing. If Jesus could be made perfect through suffering, what does that tell us about what we don't understand and happens to us? We can't explain it. We can't rationalize it. But we can grow from it. This is the hard truth at the center of having an argument with God. We can be made better without knowing why or how things happen to us. And at the heart of that is something buried in the creed, and we say it every week, and it's the forgiveness of sins. It's forgiving and being forgiven that are what comes from the heart of our tradition while we argue with God in the face of suffering. Now, before we move on in the liturgy, I want to say that this is not fatalism. There are many things the scripture says that relate to injustice, that relate to what we do to each other, that can be changed, that can be fixed, that must be addressed, that must be confronted. And we should never say, just let it go. These scriptures are about the greatest things that we cannot control and how we respond to them. And the other thing I think we should walk away with is we should never tell someone else how they can learn through their suffering. That's probably the worst thing we can do. And the next worst thing is to tell ourselves that something's happened to us for a particular moral purpose because God is trying to teach us something. There is no ground for that either. But there are great grounds for never giving up communion with God, whatever form it takes, arguing, persuading, bargaining, but in the end, listening. And listening to what Jesus said to his disciples, can you drink this cup? Learning from what Jesus said, not my will, but yours. Because we can be made perfect, we can be changed in the face of suffering, And the greatest of those is the forgiveness of sins, of forgiving and being forgiven. His words, as frail as they are, offer you in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Would you rise, please, as we sing our faith?
Brought into being and sustained by God, we give thanks for God's creatures of water, oceans and lakes and aquifers, rivers and streams and creeks and wadis, marshes and tidal flats. May we treasure their boundaries, honor their integrity, and protect their future, and support all who are their guardians. In our global Anglican Church, we pray today with thanksgiving for the people, priests, and bishops of the 8 dioceses of the Church in the province of the West Indies, under the direction of Archbishop Howard Gregory, serving Barbados, Belize, Guyana, Jamaica, Bahamas, the Northeastern Caribbean, and Aruba, Trinidad and Tobago, and the Windward Islands. And we pray God's blessing on Codrington College, the province's theological college in St. John, Barbados. In the Anglican Church of Canada, we give thanks for the people and clergy of the Diocese of Kootenay, British Columbia, and their bishop, the Right Reverend Lynn McNaughton, holding in special prayer the ministry of St. Michael and All Angels Cathedral in Kelowna and St. Saviour's Pro Cathedral in Nelson. In our diocesan cycle of prayer this week, we give thanks for the parish of Bridgewater and the Conquerals, and its church St. James, Conqueral Mills, its rector Simon Davies, and its honorary assistants, Fran Boutillier and Judy Phillips. We also give thanks for the parish of Blandford and its rector Louis Connell, and member churches St. Barnabas Blandford, All Saints Bayswater, and St. Cuthbert's Northwest Cove. We give thanks this morning for our neighboring churches, remembering especially St. George's Round Anglican Church. We pray for spiritual refreshment for the rector, Nicholas Hatton, honorary assistant, Peter Harris, director of music, Garth McPhee, and for their staff, wardens, and lay leaders. And we continue to give thanks for the gifts of all those in our parish cycle of prayer. This week, especially for Wayne Garland, Martin Gibling, Maureen White, Gretchen Gillis, Nora Jean Godwin, Randy Ball, Carrie Borowski, Kathleen Corey, Ella and Karina, Brian and Janine Hagerman, Christiane and Liam Patrick, Patrick and Pamela Hartling, Julia and Olivia. And we pray especially this week for Mary Preston, who is ill in hospital. Let us pray together with confidence, replying to the invocation, O Lord, with the response, hear our prayers. That our hearts and minds might rejoice, and that through Jesus Christ we have been reconciled to God. O Lord,
hear our prayer.
That in gratitude we might offer up ourselves, our souls, and bodies in thanksgiving for our Savior, who has died and risen for us, and evermore intercedes on our behalf. O Lord,
hear our prayer.
That in hope we might call on the Holy Spirit to enlighten our minds and break our hearts and bend our wills, that we might be reconciled with those we and our ancestors have injured in thought, word, and deed. O Lord,
hear our prayer.
That the poor and the homeless might know in our friendship the joy of walking with Jesus, who was wounded for our sins and raised for our healing, and reigns that justice might be served. O Lord,
hear our prayer.
That the Lord may reveal divine light through our presence among the sick, the weak, and the dying. O Lord,
hear our prayer.
That in this parish church we may welcome in all who seek the face of the Lord. O Lord,
hear our prayer.
And we pray now to you, O Lord, for the forgiveness of our sins against God and neighbor. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father.
In your compassion, you forgive us our sins, now and unknown. Things done and left unknown. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may be able to serve you in the business of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon us and forgive us our sins.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Please rise. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Please greet each other in peace.
Thank you.
Blessed are you, Lord God, forever and ever.
All that is in heaven and earth is yours.